Lightning is an incredible display of nature's power, and as a source of energy, it's both free and basically limitless. So you think that'd spell a recipe for renewable energy that is also, like, metal as heck. Except that the phrase, to catch lightning in a bottle, means to do something really difficult for a reason. And in the end, even if we could manage it, it might not even be worth doing. Despite how cool lightning is, at a basic level, it's not all that different from when you shock your fingers on a doorknob. Water droplets and ice particles in clouds knock each other around and throw off charged particles, creating static electricity that builds and builds, and suddenly, crack, there's your lightning strike. That discharge releases a huge amount of energy. A single lightning bolt can contain billions of joules. Billions. With a B. For reference, there's about 5,000 joules of energy in a AAA battery. A lightning-powered remote would basically never die. So, break out the tools and start building the lightning power stations, right? What are we waiting for? Well, actually, there's a problem. A few, actually. For one thing, you have to collect the lightning in the first place. So you'd have to put your power station somewhere that gets struck by lightning all the time. That'd be great in, say, stormy central Florida, but somewhere like Los Angeles, where thunderstorms are slightly rarer than unicorns, well, you can see the issue. You'd also have to deal with variability of charge. Lightning strikes can be positive or negative, which means one can literally cancel out another. So you'd need a way to store both without giving them a chance to do that. And the whole power station would have to be able to, you know, not blow up when it gets hit by lightning. But maybe the most important problem has to do with the basic nature of lightning strikes. All that energy happens all at once. That means that either we have to immediately use up a billion joules, which we don't/can't, or we have to figure out how to store it. While this could mean a battery, it's a lot more likely to mean a capacitor. The difference lies in the ways these things store energy. A battery stores energy as chemical potential energy, basically through chemical reactions. Capacitors, on the other hand, hold onto energy in pure electrical form. At their most basic, capacitors are two pieces of conducting material called plates with an insulator in between. When a capacitor is charging, one plate is grabbing electrons and one plate is losing electrons, creating a charge difference between the two plates. When it's discharged, all the electrons flow from one plate to the other until things equal out in there, releasing all the stored energy. No chemical reaction necessary. In general, capacitors charge up way faster, so they're better for situations where you're getting electrical energy pumped in quickly, like getting hit by lightning. Plus, unlike batteries, capacitors can be recharged over and over again without losing any oomph, which is critical if you're collecting lightning strikes over and over. If you've ever owned a cell phone, you know a battery ain't gonna last that long. So there are a few challenges to building our lightning power station, but it's not like people haven't thought about ways to do it. One study in particular, published in 2022, actually lays out a way that some scientists believe it could be done. The overall layout of the plant would be pretty simple. A lightning rod connected to two capacitors. The hardest part of the whole thing is the capacitor itself. Designing something that can charge that much, that fast, isn't easy. The researcher's proposal calls for a capacitor that uses copper for the plates and mica for the insulating guts. Copper, because it would be most stable in this situation, and mica for its top-tier insulating ability. It would have to be one big capacitor, but theoretically, it could get the job done. But before I tell you that, we need to keep the lights on.
Thank you for supporting SciShow. Thank you for being a part of this incredible community in the comments section. Thank you for telling your friends and enemies about SciShow. And thank you for enjoying the 2025 Complexly calendars that we've made for you. And that's right, I said Complexly calendars because they're really about bringing together all of the Complexly shows in one super cool piece of merch. That means we're showcasing Crash Course, Eons, Bizarre Beasts, Study Hall, and your favorite SciShow channels. The theme is a quarter century of progress. So each month celebrates something from the last 25 years that gives us hope about how far we've come and just how many possibilities lay ahead. Like one month, we're celebrating mRNA vaccines, and another is all about expeditions aboard the International Space Station, but I won't spoil all of them for you. In this calendar, you also get beautiful wall art, courtesy of the incredible Emily Alvarez. Now, we're only making a limited number of these, so get them while you can at complexly.store/calendar or the link in the description. Every purchase of a Complexly calendar supports the SciShow team. So again, thank you for your support.
But even if we could make that fancy lightning power station, it might not be worth it. Because lightning isn't energy in and of itself. It produces energy, and not as much as you'd think. Let me explain, and bear with me because there's gonna be some math. You can imagine a lightning bolt, a cloud, and the ground as making up an electrical circuit. When you're dealing with an electrical circuit, you need to keep track of three main things. You have current, which you can think of as the rate of electron flow. You have voltage, which you can think of as the driving force pushing electrons through a circuit. And you have power, which is how fast a system will use energy in the form of electricity. Each lightning bolt has a current of about 100 kiloamps and a voltage of around 10 megavolts. And luckily for us, there's a cool formula we can use here to get the one thing we're missing. Power. It comes from a famous law known as Ohm's law, and it's, if you'll pardon my pun, shockingly easy. Power equals voltage times current. Simple. Plug in the values, and each lightning bolt nets us about 1,000 gigawatts of power. But we still have to get to usable energy, which is power times time. And here is where it starts to fall apart. Each lightning bolt only lasts about 30 microseconds, so all that power only nets you about 30 watt seconds of energy. Convert those units, and you get about 8 kilowatt hours of energy per lightning strike. And here's the kicker. On average, one household uses about 30 kilowatt hours of energy per day. We'd need around 3 lightning strikes per day to power a single home. And the most lightning-y place on Earth, which is Lake Maracaibo in Venezuela, has less than 1 strike per square kilometer per day. As cool as lightning power sounds, it turns out to be a whole lot more trouble than it's worth. Things like solar, wind, and geothermal, though, now those are some viable sustainable strategies. Maybe a little less flashy, but they'll do us a whole lot more good moving towards a greener future.